much older than I look. I'm really not a child, you know.
This is part one of my discussions with scientists about the complications and conflicts involved in the journey from a drug discovery in the lab to its eventual application in the clinic. The process is a labyrinth of agendas, fraught with differing financial models and scientific interests.
What we're trying to do here in the aging field is not very different, practically speaking, from what medical researchers are doing and drug companies are doing all over the world. What we're trying to do is make molecules that will prevent and treat diseases. What makes this different is that one of these drugs, let's say it treats type 2 diabetes, may also treat and prevent Alzheimer's, heart disease, and cancer, among other things. And I think that that's possible to do. What that will do, it will lead to a blockbuster drug if it really happens.
You have major enterprises in this country, pharmaceutical industries, lawyers and lawsuits against doctors, the AMA, very large enterprises with entrenched interests in the status quo.
But it's an evolution. I don't think that will make people say, oh, well, we don't need to work on cancer anymore or heart disease or type 2 diabetes. What it means is they'll say, ah, we can make these types of molecules. Let's do better. And we'll constantly improve upon those. And I'm not worried that we're going to make a silver bullet that will be as good as we can get.
Now, the only thing I'm really not worried, but you could raise the question if there were sort of a magic bullet, silver bullet, that would hit multiple diseases of aging all at once, that it would render obsolete some of the drugs that are out there now. And again, you're bucking against vested, entrenched interests.
In the cross currents of business, government, and the media, information and misinformation, anything is possible.